Okay, do I have everybody's attention? Thank you. The Greater Victoria School District wishes to recognize and acknowledge the Esquimalt and Songhees Nations on whose traditional territories we live, we learn, and we do our work. Good evening and welcome on behalf of the Board of Education, School District 61. I have regrets from Trustee Lauren Kahunga, who is absent due to a tragic family loss, and regrets also from Trustee Elaine Leonard. To clarify the purpose of tonight's meeting, each table has a trustee along with a recorder. Members of the public are welcome to move from table to table. After reporting out, trustees will be available for individual questions. The board is seeking input from our community of educational partners for your priorities for the board's budget as required under the School Act. We are also seeking your input about what resources and staffing that you feel would be necessary to ensure students receive a properly structured and funded education. So if we can get started at those discussions, about 8:25, I will be stopping the discussion and we'll start our reporting out. But you can get started and hopefully we will have more people joining us. Thank you, and looking forward to seeing the comments.
We're out into regular classes. I was an itinerant teacher. I had 6 to 8 students on my caseload. I saw them probably 3 times a week for 45 minutes to an hour each time.
6 to 8 students per...
per caseload, that's it.
Okay. And were they were all in the same location, or they were throughout the district?
No, they were throughout the district.
Yeah, okay.
So I drove to where they were.
Right.
And I would take them, I'd either work with them in the classroom, depending on their age.
Right.
Or I would pull them out and I would work one-on-one with them, developing content, or it depended on their age group. So if they were kindergartens or primary students, I'd be working on language, speech production, vocabulary development, and then, you know, themes that the teacher was working on in class, I would be reviewing that and practicing that with them. Okay. And there was no issue about finding a place to work, and that's a huge point now. And the kids were at 6 to 8 different schools.
So I just want to make sure I understand. When you say finding a place to work, you mean a space within the school?
Yes.
Or just... Okay.
That is quiet and appropriate.
Right. Okay.
And at the time, I was responsible for their assistive listening equipment, which at that time involved the hearing aids that they were wearing and the personal FM equipment that we were putting on teachers. And I don't know if you... saw any when you were at Sir James Douglas, but we did have students there. The teacher wears a microphone and transmitter, and the kids wore receivers attached to their hearing aids.
Yeah.
Okay, we still do that now.
Okay,
but I was responsible for that equipment.
Okay,
and I still am, and I interact with the audiologists who assess the students and determine what their needs are in terms of the equipment they have. Then I was also responsible for any interpreters that worked with them.
Right.
Okay, so some of the students used sign language to communicate. They didn't have oral skills.
Mm-hmm.
So I was responsible for supporting those students and supporting the classroom teacher in using the EAs or the interpreters appropriately.
Right. Okay.
And, of course, wrote IEPs for those 6 to 8 students.
Right.
Okay, now.
So we're talking about 84, 85.
Right.
Like that. Yeah.
Right. Now I have 24 students.
And sorry, and just remind me in terms of the context, in 84, 85, where are we with the whole notion of integrated classrooms?
It was just beginning.
It's just beginning,
just
okay.
Just beginning. So in that next 10 years from 84 to 94, probably in that 10 years, more kids integrated, fewer kids in special classes. We closed special classes, and now they are all integrated.
Right.
Okay, so now as of, 94. Five, probably. They were all closed.
Right. So I want to come back to that point a little bit later, but I'd sure need to talk more about how this thing is evolved.
Okay, so, and before, in that time period, and up to 2000, the funding was done on a need. how much support were those kids going to need?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then the government changed the funding formula and they did it per student.
Right.
Okay. Victoria was still sort of okay because we had a lot of deaf and hard of hearing students. So the economy of scale, not every child needed an interpreter, right? But those districts that had one or two and they needed an interpreter, I don't know how they did. They must have stolen from one budget to anyhow.
You would, as we do now, when we don't. There are special needs funding. Of course, is far less than we actually spend, in the district. So that.
Well, so what's happened now is we have a list that of students that are designated deaf and hard of hearing. They meet the criteria.
Right.
Okay. And we get a certain amount of funding per student, and from that block of funding, the principal of special ed has to come up with, okay, what kind of support do I need for them? In order to get the funding, the ministry has a regulation that says they have to have regular, frequent, ongoing support by a teacher of the deaf, a qualified teacher of the deaf. So you can't just have somebody who has a special ed degree. They have to have a degree in deaf education. Okay, so that puts us into a higher pay scale. And I've been in the district a long time, so I'm at max. So is my colleague. And we're probably one of the most expensive ones to pay for in terms of teachers. From that list, I now have 24 students on my caseload, as opposed to 6 or 8.
Right.
I have 16 schools I go to. All of those 24 kids, 5 of them aren't even being designated deaf and hard of hearing. They're being designated autism or PDCH, which is the chronic health category.
Mm-hmm.
My colleague, who has 19 students,
mm-hmm.
she's carrying 3 deafblind students who don't get covered, called deaf and hard of hearing.
How would that be? The categorization, the criteria has changed?
They are only allowed to be under one category.
Oh, I see. And whereas 20 years ago?
Whatever their needs were?
What was met.
Was met.
Right, okay. Okay.
So the caseload for generating funds to pay for deaf and hard of hearing isn't reflective of the reality.
Mm-hmm.
Because, in fact, those kids that are multiple mm-hmm. categories take a huge amount
yeah.
more time.
Yeah.
The deaf-blind should be a category on their own, but that's a whole other ball
mm-hmm.
of wax.
Mm-hmm.
And I go to 16 schools.
Right.
Okay. So now, instead of being able to work 3 times a week with a student and a teacher and really support the program, I'm more like a consultant. And I show up and they go, oh yeah, you're Pam.
Yeah.
Instead of, oh, thank goodness, here's what we're working on. Let's do some teamwork here.
Yeah. How long would you, how long would you spend in a classroom with a child? Let's say you go to a school, there's one child there that has some needs. Given your case, so what does that look like kind of in any given day?
Looks like at about 30, 45 minutes.
Okay.
Once a week, maybe. And then don't forget, I go K to 12.
Right.
So then the high schools have set schedules. I can't just drop in. I have to go when the student maybe has a block that is appropriate for me to go work with them.
Right.
So then I have to look at my high school students first and plug them in.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have to go to my elementary teachers and say, okay, here's what's left.
Yeah.
And then I have to go look at when is there space available for me. Because the counselors want the one room, the speech path wants the one room, the teacher, the visually impaired, wants the one room, the psychologist wants that one room, if there's a room in the school.
So, two things come to mind when asked about. One is obviously money and resource, and the other thing is how we organize ourselves as a school system, how we organize our classrooms with our special needs kids. The money thing, I assume, because we're all probably in agreement on this, we need more money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know what else is important, too?
Yeah.
Like, it used to be that the teachers were given 3 hours a month
mm-hmm.
under our contract to meet with the experts in the area to prepare materials, to discuss how they were doing at reaching the goals on the IEP, to create the IEP. Right. Now, they're not given any time. I have to beg teachers to meet me on their lunch hour, or before school, or after school. It's put me in a position of, you know, I'm uncomfortable asking them to give up a lunch hour. And honestly, they need their break if they even get it at lunchtime. You know that the teachers are so busy at lunchtime.
So it's building it into the fabric, if I can put it that way, the school system. So 20 years ago, was the case that it would be. What happened? Would it get a
TOC?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then all of us would sort of cycle through,
right?
So that TOC was used in that school,
right? So this is built right into their budget, the whole thing. And in terms of the way we organize our classrooms now, I hear varying things from teachers of your capability who do this kind of work and wonder aloud whether maybe we've got sometimes the balance right of how we integrate our kids in the classroom and all that stuff. I don't know if you have any thoughts about that.
I do. I think that you can't make a rule because my students who, if their technology is working, and they have the kind of knowledgeable, experienced teacher working in that grade, some of them can handle three of my students in their class. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I work with one kindergarten teacher who is phenomenal, who does have three of my students in their class. But I might not ask that of somebody who wasn't as experienced as this teacher. You know, you get multiple special needs kids in a class. So my kids with the technology, teachers tend to think that, okay, as long as I've got the microphone on, they're hearing me, right? But there's more to hearing well in a classroom than just amplifying a voice. And then you have the child who maybe has a behavior issue, or somebody with autism in the class, as well as my student. Okay, the teacher's going to be drawn to the squeaky wheel. You can't help it. So my student's going to get less attention. I need to make sure that that student really does understand what's going on in that class, that they do understand the vocabulary and the homework for that class or that assignment. And it gets really hard on teachers to have three special needs kids in their class. And there are classes that have more than four.
And again, I guess it really depends, too. You talk about the teacher, the very, you know, kind of teacher involved, but it also probably depends on the kids, too. Three kids, you know, may be very different from another three kids in another classroom.
That's right. So, you know, some of my kids are in a class where they're the least needy.
Yeah. Interesting.
So, and sometimes, you know, in the early grades, there are kids in there that we just don't have a designation on them yet, but we know we just have to get the paperwork done on them because you know there's a challenge there for those kids. But so a kindergarten teacher or a grade one teacher could have some that are designated and then others that they know, okay, we need to get working on it, but they still have to deal with it. They still have to try and teach this class of kids.
So what I hear often from teachers who've been in the system for a while is they generally support the idea of integration of kids, but they said from the moment it happened, there was never sufficient support in the system. Do you share that observation?
Yes. Yes. Very much so. It is the rare classroom I walk into where I feel that the teacher is finishing the day feeling like they taught everybody something that day.
Mm-hmm.
That they were able to do a great day's work of providing a learning environment that everybody was able to learn in. You know, But the other side of it too, Michael, is that you can't just keep tossing in educational assistance, because the teacher still has to supervise those adults and tell them and direct them, here's what I want you to do here and here and here. So, I mean, a class with five ed assistants isn't ideal either, right? But certainly more than what they're getting these days.
Yeah.
I think the challenge is mostly for the ones that are labeled LD or the high incident students, that the school gets given a block of money,
right,
and then they decide how they're going to divvy it up,
yeah,
right? So, you know, you hear teachers saying things like, well, they're only LD for the 2 hours in the morning that I have the ed assistant. The rest of the time, they're normal, right? And we know. It's just teachers trying to explain in a simple way the challenge that they're facing,
yeah,
you know?
Can you tell me about some things, a success story or two, that things are a place where you think things are going great or well?
Do I really want to, should I be naming names?
Oh, no, please.
Yeah.
Please don't do that, because we don't want to disclose anybody's private information.
No.
But in general, you know, in general terms, without naming schools or anything, to give a sense of.
Yeah, I do. I, you know, that is one of the great joys about my job, is
yeah,
I get to walk into these amazing classrooms with these master teachers,
yeah,
and I just sit in awe watching,
yeah,
many of them.
Yeah.
Okay, so yes, there are some fabulous classrooms, and there are some fabulous teachers who are able to handle these multi-challenges, but you know what? They get tired of always having that every year,
mm-hmm,
because they're able to do it.
Mm-hmm. What do you think makes them successful in your view, from in your experience and in watching the way things happen in the classroom?
They are aware of what every child is doing in their classroom at all times.
Mm.
You know, I am in awe of kindergarten teachers, truly in awe.
Yeah.
And I have had the privilege to be in two that I can think of right off the top of my head, because those kids come in sort of without any concept of what school's about, without any knowledge of, we have to work together here. We can't just be individuals running around the classroom.
Yeah.
And the teacher has this curriculum of stuff that they have to teach these kids.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't just, okay, here, sit down, learn it. You know, you have to be so dynamic with kindergarten kids and a multi-discipline approach to how you present material and multiple ways of presenting the same material and integrating themes with all the materials that you're doing. And they just keep pulling stuff out of the back of their back pocket, you know, that they used before. This is going to work on this one. Right? This is what this one really means. But at the same time, you know, we have to...
That's not connecting with that child over there.
And so we have to come up with something else over here.
Yeah.
And they're doing it at the same time. You know? It's just like this...
That's remarkable.
It is remarkable to watch. It's just a joy.
Mm.
I worry about all the teachers that Victoria is going to be retiring in the next 5 years, and that incredible knowledge is going to be lost.
Yeah.
They need to set up a mentorship program.
So that's a really interesting point, and actually one just put on my hat as BC School Trustees Association president, one that I have spoken with the minister about, and one that he's actually very supportive of. And I don't know if you know this, but the ministry is now working with the BCTF to develop a mentorship program. It's right now on a smaller scale. They're putting some seed money into it in a few districts around the province. To try that very thing, because I think people think it's a good idea, and if it works, spread out. But you'd think intuitively, you know, it would be something.
You would think it's obvious.
Yeah.
But you know, you have to spend time in classrooms, and I think that you know, not enough trustees maybe go around and spend time in classrooms and just spend a day.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, I talk about kindergarten teachers, but then it's at the other end too. The high school teachers,
yeah,
you know, they have a demanding age group to work with there too,
yeah,
and some of those teachers are just phenomenal. How they hold the entire class in the palm of their hand,
yeah,
as they start doing you know, the history of World War II. I mean, I can think of one teacher that my son had that was, I mean, my son is not really a history. He's a techno geek, right?
But
he loved this class because the teacher loved what he was teaching, right? And he made it come alive for them. And the final project that he had them do was like, get into character. You had to be one of these people.
Yeah.
At the end of World War II that was signing the armistice. And you had to research, you know, what you were going to say. And you had to be your character, not what you thought ought to have happened, you know? And then they had this debate. And, you know, the fun they had in prepping for that and the knowledge they learned and what they retained, you know, my son, you know, 6 years after graduation, still talks about that class.
Is it a teacher who's still teaching?
Yes.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. To come back to the this is sort of a variation on the mentorship question. It's about how we train teachers and thinking about, you're talking about the retirements. One of the issues I think the trustees grapple with, and we've talked to the ministry and others, and we try to engage our colleagues at the university level, is the training for teachers and the education faculty. Do you have any sort of connection with that, or is that an issue that is of that you've put
for
your mind
me,
to?
Yeah, for me it's an issue. We as Teachers of the Deaf have contacted UVic and their pro-year teachers to ask if we can do presentations on working with a teacher of the deaf, having a student in their class who's deaf and hard of hearing, the issues. And we have a slideshow presentation. We do it for the educational assistant training program. Mm-hmm. We go in and do a half-day workshop for them. We're left with, you know, we offer it to UVic.
Yes.
And if they take us up on it, but we can't force it on them.
Yes.
I'm feeling that the courses that are being offered in terms of special ed, this may be a generalization, so take it with a grain of salt, but the teacher who teaches it that term comes from a particular expertise, doesn't have an expertise on all the areas of special ed,
right?
And the kids tend to get a lot more on their area of expertise, because of course that's where they're comfortable, and not a lot on the others. I really think that the university should be inviting people like myself who have offered, and you can get others in, it's not that hard, to come and present on their particular area. When they see the presentation that we do, like, the students just rave about it.
Yeah.
You know, so they like it. They just don't know what they're not getting until they get out there.
So that speaks to something that the university should be doing in a more systematic way, approach to it. We've attempted to speak to the minister, well, we've spoken to the minister about to him attempting to put more pressure on. There's some resistance, I think it's fair to say, because they're used to controlling the whole thing, and they will do what they think is appropriate. Thank you. I hope that's changing. I really do, and I hope the more, like, the opportunity you get to be part of the system and others that I know, that culture will change. There's nothing to feel threatened about, but if we don't give that training to kids now, how can we expect them to be engaged in the classroom when they get there?
Because there are so many special needs kids in every classroom. You will not have a class that doesn't have a range of special needs kids in your class, in your very first class.
Yeah.
You know, and we need to be at least exposing these future teachers to at least a bit of the information so that they know where to go to get help if they get one of these. You can't possibly teach them everything they're going to need to know about teaching a deaf or hard of hearing student, but you can give them a broad picture and also give them a ask for help. You know, there are experts in your school district. That's the other challenge, you know, that we have. You know, we might not go to a school for 5 years because there's no deaf or hard of hearing student in there. So the teachers who reside in that school maybe don't know that there's a teacher of the deaf in the district, right?
Do you work with autistic kids? Is there sometimes...
Yes.
So this is probably an unfair question to ask, but I'll try it on anyways. Everybody that I speak to in this area tells me, and the numbers seem to suggest, there's a rising number of kids with autism, I suppose, which it can be somewhat attributable to maybe we were diagnosing.
Better diagnosis, perhaps.
But I'm also told that, no, for those who've been around a while, that the number is actually rising. Do you have any sense of that or why that might be?
I think that the Asperger's number probably is rising. I'm not sure about the autism. I think, I'm just not sure that they stayed in school very long.
Right.
I think that they ended up being pulled out to do some special programming or whereas they stay in school now, right? But I think the Asperger's group has definitely expanded. I think part of that for sure is because we have a better understanding of the range. Mm-hmm. And but there is some research to show, you know, that
hi
Sue, that
were you attracted like by the microphone, Sue?
Pardon?
Were you attracted by the microphone?
I didn't see it when I came here.
The Silicon Valley, you know, has studied, you know, there's a huge increase in the population of Asperger's kids that are going to school in the Silicon Valley. Well, it's that spectrum, right? A normal is a broad spectrum, but if you're here and you marry somebody who's here and you have kids, your kids are here on that spectrum, right? So in the Silicon Valley, huge rise in the incidence there. So, you know, I think in general it's better diagnosis now, but maybe, well, I don't know. You know, there's this whole discussion about environmental impact and chemicals that are in our environment that we don't realize the impact they've been having on our bodies, and maybe not our bodies, but our children.
Interesting. Is there anything else on there that you wanted to cover that I haven't asked?
Okay, well, if there's one thing that I could hammer home to you, it's about the lack of workspace.
Okay.
It is the biggest
problem. So there's some irony in that. It struck me as you were saying that at the beginning, because probably 20 odd years ago, 25 years ago, we were pretty much bursting at the seams. Our numbers were probably in a hot 25,000 plus, with essentially, not completely, but essentially the same kind of square footage we have now. Now, we've shrunk our capacity a bit, but you know, there are some schools where there's considerable space, and probably others where there isn't. I think of the George J., there's probably a lot of space, but a Doncaster, maybe not so much. Mm-hmm. Is it something that varies, or how do you generally think it's true?
No, I think it's across the board now. I mean, it used to be when we had half-day kindergartens, I could go into the kindergarten classroom and work in there.
Right.
Because remember, I need a quiet space.
Yeah.
I can't work in the hall. Every school I go into has desks and chairs in the hall, and teachers are sending kids out to do work at that table if they need. But you know what? There's a lot of people that walk up and down school hallways.
Yeah.
It's noisy, it's distracting, and you know, if I'm going to do useful work in that 35 to 45 minutes that I get to be there, it needs to be a quiet space where I can have their attention and they're not distracted. And Sue's school is a perfect example because they have a space, and they even have labels on the door: speech and language pathologist, behavioral therapist. Two doors going into the same space.
Right.
Yeah. And when I come, I only come, her school, I come twice a week because I have two students there. Yay, I don't have to drive to two different schools that afternoon. But the psychologist is in there too, and she's taken a day and a half. Okay, so remember when I was trying to juggle my schedule?
The counselor,
is it the counselor?
Yeah, she's the counselor.
Okay, the counselor's in there a day and a half. Mm-hmm. And then there's the speech path who's in there for a day?
A day.
A day.
And then we have the mentor program, because the boys and girls mentoring program, they're coming into our school as well.
So, but you know what? The principals want to find space, so then they say, well, how about this little room in the library? Well, it's just off the library, but it's where the server is kept, and it has this huge fan going. Okay. Willows, lovely school.
Yeah.
They have a room that is labeled itinerant specialists, okay, but the speech path,
all competing for that same space,
and they have a schedule, and I'm on it, but oops, the nurses came to do their hearing vision screening, and they're in there today. So now in my 35 minutes, now I spend half of it trying to find a place to work.
Well, you probably come to the right table, because we have the facilities guy right here, so that's probably actually quite opportune to put that in the file folder to something to consider.
It is not just me. If you talk to the Speech Pass, they've made presentations on it. Okay. If you talk to any of the itinerant staff, it's huge. Especially when you've got this kind of caseload and you're in and out.
Right.
As I say, if you're wasting half your time trying to find a place to work and you only see the child once a week.
Yeah.
It's interesting that the space is already identified at some locations, but when you're scheduled to arrive, it's in use by somebody else.
Because, you know, they only come for the hearing and vision screening on a particular day, and the principal has got to find a quiet space for them. So then you start going, okay, who's away today? No, seriously.
Well, and something, speaking, if I can just interject, at Vic West School, which is where I teach, we had an extra room for years, and we made it a low-incidence room, and that's where kids that had Asperger's, autism, special needs, that needed a program that involved them jumping on a trampoline, rolling on a mat, getting inside a tent, rocking in a chair, or just having a quiet space. We had that room for years, and now we don't have it. And boy, we are suffering because of it. The kids have nowhere to go. So sometimes they might go to the behavior support room, which is not appropriate for them. There's kids who are having breakdowns in there, and they're having, like, they're being fragile emotionally, and our kids are needing a quiet space. So we're really pushed again, you know, we have the same kind of difficulty. So in the back of my classroom, which is a learning assistance room, maybe I'll have a trampoline set up there. So I'm trying to teach my kids, who are all kind of ADHD and have challenges paying attention, and there's kids in the back being a bit noisy on the trampoline because that's what they need. And the gym is being utilized a lot of the time, so otherwise they could go there. And
you know, in desperation, I've used the vice principal's office, but it's set up for an adult. The desk is up here, the chairs are up here, and I'm working with a kindergarten student, right? And then they have all their personal stuff there because they weren't anticipating somebody coming to use their office. So I'm like trying to close stuff off and put it away and find a... It's just
difficult, hard. You know, with the day in, day out things that administrators have to deal with, it's not necessarily the top list, but I think from a district perspective, it was something that we thought was important and make a priority. That's something that, for example, Seamus's department can look at and focus in and figure out what the needs are across the district. And,
okay, well, while I'm here, can I put in a bid for itinerants to be provided with a vehicle the same as maintenance staff? Do you know that when I started, the mileage that I would get from my car would pay for the gas, new tires, a brake job, and an oil job every year? Right. Now it just barely covers the gas.
It hasn't kept pace.
Yeah, and it doesn't cover replacement costs of the vehicle either.
Yeah.
And then, okay, so I'm looking at buying a new car.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm thinking, okay, do I buy the new car for me?
Yeah.
Or do I buy it for the job that I do? Because you should see what's in the back of my car. Because when you work K to 12, you're carrying all your materials back there. I was joking with one of my students today, well, this is your bag, and this is the other child's bag.
Besides getting a mileage, is there any income tax claims you
can make
as well?
If you buy your car new, then you can fill out the income tax form for having to use your vehicle for work. And for the first 5 years or so, the depreciation, you actually do get money back.
Right.
After that, you know,
just
so you might as well not bother.
Depreciation.
Okay.
So that hasn't kept pace. And remind me, Seamus, sorry, maybe this is not your department, but the that number that we set for mileage and so forth, is that that's just a district policy? Is that something we approve as a board, the bylaw?
Yes, it actually is one of the better ones in the province.
Yeah.
We did a survey, and
we're actually higher than government.
Is that right?
Yeah. Okay. But it doesn't change where I sit here
still,
in terms of, you know, when
it's
I...
out of your pocket.
I'm taking the car in tomorrow, it'll cost me $800.
Yeah.
And if I don't have a car, I can't do the job.
Right.
The other thing I didn't talk about was the change in FM, sound field equipment.
Okay.
When I started, there wasn't sound field equipment in schools. And do you know what I mean by that?
So I don't.
So that's where the teacher wears a microphone, but there are speakers in the classroom so that their voice is broadcast into the room.
Right.
So that no matter where you are in the room, everybody hears equally, as if they were this far away.
Right. Okay. Okay. No, I have seen that. Yeah.
Okay. So, there are kids in our who have a hearing loss, whose hearing loss was not sufficient to put hearing aids on, but causes a huge problem for them in a classroom because of all the background noise. They can't get the teacher's voice. So we've purchased over time 40 systems and put them into classrooms, and every year we move them. Now, way back in 1984, maintenance would do it for us. Okay, but then in the change of the funding formula, maintenance decided that they couldn't do it for free anymore. They'd have to charge the special ed budget. So now, out of the DHH budget,
they charge back.
Yeah. So now they have to account for paying to move them. Well, guess who moves them now? So now my car has to carry.
And how does that work with our QP employees? Is that okay? Just one of those things?
Well,
it's portable.
I know a little bit about this.
Ours are.
The district's purchased quite a number of fixed systems recently.
Yeah.
I know at Great Flower and Shoreline.
So under the First Nations graduation completion goal.
And some of the newer renovations, they've had the systems.
Yes, they've put them in. So these are permanently installed infrared sound field systems.
Right.
We can talk more about that. Okay, so they didn't tell us they were putting them in. So then we get kids coming in, and now there's the sound field equipment in there, and ours is coming in with personal FM equipment, and we're now asking the teacher to wear two microphones, one for the sound field and one for the FM, because it's infrared and FM. They're two different broadcasting mechanisms.
So we have speakers going to every child, and for some kids
who wear hearing aids,
they're plugged in, but you need a separate system.
So then I'm phoning up the manufacturer or the audiologist and saying, okay, can I plug this FM into the broadcaster for the infrared?
Right.
And what is the sound quality like? Because it's not just a simple matter of plugging it in. It's what are they hearing? And yes, I can listen to it, but it's just not simple, right? And there's a communication.
I'm just going to say, speaking of them, sound. So in something like that, would we not be talking to one another? That the people who are doing the work be talking with the folks?
I'm
not saying it's deliberate or anything. Sometimes you just don't think about those things.
Okay, so here's how it came about, is that we walked in to put one into a school and found it there. So then we started asking questions, and we found out what schools they were in terms of for the First Nations. The other thing we come across is that Health and Safety puts in sound field equipment for teachers who have vocal strain. Fabulous and appropriate, but they just show up. And FMs, those ones are FM, and our students run on FM, and if they're on the same channel, they interfere. So we need to know where they are, okay, and what channel they're broadcasting on, so that we can change our students.
Right.
Because theirs is fixed, ours is not. We can change ours.
Right.
So that's an aspect as well. So in terms of 1984 and 2011, I didn't manage sound field. Now I manage 40.
Is the technology that much better now than it was?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Every classroom should have sound field in it. Oh. Every classroom. The research that, I can give you the research on it in terms of students' reading scores, their academic scores, they all go up. Mm. The kids who have English as a second language benefit because they hear what the teacher's saying clearly. The distance, the degradation of the teacher's voice across distance, it's not arithmetic, it's logarithmic as you go
It's like Wi-Fi signals.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so, the guys at the back of the room that had the horrible reputation for being big lugs and not academic and they're just messing around,
they just couldn't hear.
So they're going to entertain themselves in a classroom that has everybody hearing really well. When the teacher says, okay, we're going to turn to page 24, nobody goes, what page are we turning to? Everybody knows it's page 24. They do it. There you go.
Yeah.
So in these classes that have bigger classes, like high school, they need sound field. Now, the districts are starting with K to 5. If you look at West Van, all their schools, K to 5, have sound field in their classroom. North Van, K to 5 is what they're working on. They've got K to 3 for sure. They're working on K to 5. But you can see I'm passionate
what is
about
what is
this.
Just out of curiosity, what does a unit cost? So a standard unit you put into a, there's a $1,000 a classroom, thereabouts?
Economy of scale. I mean, if you only buy five, it costs us about $1,300.
Right.
So $1,300 per five. Over, if you're only going to buy one, it's going to cost you about $1,500. But if you're going to buy 100, you're going to get them for $1,000.
I know when we did Craig Flower, for instance, we came in around $1,000 a classroom.
Yeah. Now, the other issue about that is you got to train the teachers. And you have to train them every year because the teachers move out of Craig Flower and new ones move in. And they don't know why that thing is in the corner of their room. Hmm. And they don't know how it works. And they don't know the research on why they should be using it. Tillicum, I went in and I have two students there. And last year I presented to the staff about all the equipment because they're all wired up. And they're like, you know, some of them are using it, some of them aren't. And, you know, the number one point to make about sound field is it's not making your voice louder, it's making it
just
clearer.
Heard.
So you get some teachers who say, oh, I have a big voice, I can broadcast to the back of the room. Well, when you raise your voice, you put more emphasis on the vowels, and the clarity is carried on the consonants. So you're not improving clarity, you're reducing clarity by raising your voice. Hmm. So
it's not just a matter of putting it in and they will come. There has to be
education.
And now we're
back to the pro-year students at UVic who need that education. You know, if we could get those teachers in that year teaching them about using sound field equipment and why it's important, they will go out and they'll start asking, well, where is it?
Right. You
know, and they'll know why they should be using it. And we won't have the vocal strain issue either.
In every school, how many of these systems would you say exist on average in elementary school, for example, in Victoria?
In Victoria? Mm-hmm. Well, what have we got? Doncaster, Craig Flower, Tillicum?
Shoreline.
Does George Jay? I'm not in George Jay, my colleague.
I don't think George Jay.
So.
Michael, it's something that obviously is not funded from, it's not a requirement of the facilities.
Right.
I know John and the associates have attempted to find money as time has moved on and made that available to us and we've got to have them installed. The lady is perfectly correct, Pam, right?
Yep.
In that there was a huge cost in relocating and having these systems chase teachers around. So we were advocating for more systems so that it is still there.
So how many classrooms do we have in the district? 600 classrooms?
Easily.
So you could get up to big numbers, but phased in over time.
Mm-hmm.
And definitely infrared is the way to go, because I was just at South Park the other day where I have an FM system and they're using walkie-talkies there and they're getting interference both on their walkie-talkies and on their FM system that I have, and they don't know where it's coming from. Mm-hmm. Infrared works on line of sight. If you aren't in line of sight to the thing,
right,
it won't broadcast anything.
That's interesting. So just out of, I don't know the science of it, but infrared just means a different frequency that it operates on?
Yeah, so like in a spectrum of light, infrared is at one end, AM, FM.
Right, okay.
Okay. And so, like, if we pretended that the...
it doesn't go through walls and stuff like that.
No.
Right.
So when the teacher walks out the classroom door, they're not broadcasting anymore,
mm-hmm.
which is a benefit, too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You don't have to turn it off.
Interesting to know whether people think of the safety of all these signals and so forth. They're talked about all the time, whether there's any difference between
infrared and Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
Well, infrared is light, and FM is a radio wave.
Okay.
But like this, okay, we can get into that discussion if you want. This room's filled with FM radio waves right now. We're just not tuned into them.
Right. Some of us aren't. We can play them in our cavities, you know. that's actually very, that's fascinating. It can make a real difference in the lives of kids in classrooms. And every child is what you're saying,
yes,
too.
Every child.
Yeah. It's great.
But do you want to talk about...
It's okay. I was enjoying listening to you, because even though you come to my school and even though I'm case manager for two of our students that you serve, we never have time to talk.
No, and I did bring that up about how there just isn't time to talk. And, you know, one of the reasons that I can still somewhat manage to do this job is because I've been doing it so long.
Right.
And I know so many people in the district, yeah. Right? I don't waste time trying to figure out who I have to talk to about a particular challenge. I know, and I go find them. So, you know, I know Wayne the custodian, or, yeah. You know, yeah. I know Kathy, the admin assistant, is the one to ask for this question. Or, but, you know, when I retire and you get your new teacher of the deaf and hard of hearing, they're not going to be able to handle this kind of caseload and this kind of driving around. They just simply would not be able to do the job.
Yeah, well, then that's a mentoring. The thing you spoke about, the mentoring speaks.
And they might not want to do the job either. Yes, there is that issue. You're absolutely right. I had a student teacher, and after she spent the 3 weeks with me,
yeah.
She decided not to become a teacher of the deaf because she said, I don't have a home if I'm an itinerant teacher. Mm-hmm. I don't belong anywhere. Mm-hmm. I don't have colleagues to have lunch with. I don't have lunch. Mm-hmm. I drive in my car to the next school.
Right.
When you have now these 45-minute breaks instead of an hour,
mm-hmm.
And okay, the 15 minutes when school finishes, I'm writing up what just happened,
mm-hmm.
Then I get in my car, I eat my sandwich in the car on the way to getting to my next school where I find out what workspace I can work in.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's not very efficient.
Right?
So there's always been an itinerant nature to what you do.
Right.
It's just that in the past, with the caseload being smaller, you're able to spend a longer amount of time in school, maybe a day, I don't know.
That's right. I would spend a morning, so then I'd spend recess with my colleagues, and I'd be able to casually chat with them and, you know, mention things that come up, but it wasn't like a pressured, I got to tell you this because I've got to go, you know?
Right. Yeah. Big difference culturally in the school, mm-hmm. how you build the community in the school. Mm-hmm.
Very much so. Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, job satisfaction is an issue.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for sharing all that. It's really,
no, I feel like I just went.
No, it's great. I mean, I learn. This is how I learn what I do, and when I speak, you know, with ministers or you know, whoever it is, when we're advocating on issues of public education, it really informs what I do. The stories actually informs what I do. We talk a lot about numbers, which are important. But the stories and talking about how things happen in the classroom, that's actually more powerful than pretty much any number that you mail off. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, it sure does.
So Pam, when it was decided what type of system, were you consulted? Was there any discussion?
Not at all.
No.
For the school district's equipment?
Yes,
not at all.
Okay.
No.
Interesting.
Yeah. And that's something I think one of the things that come away from this discussion, I think Seamus can take with him, and I think without even, and that's not something we'd have to take to the board, I think that's something that just makes some sense to talk to the folks who are actually doing the work and use the equipment and can educate others about the equipment.
Like the audiovisual guys,
yeah.
We talk all the time. Like Joel and I, mm-hmm. You know, if I've got a problem with something, I'll send him an email and say, you know, notice this happening at Tillicum in this room. What's the warranty on that one? How long has it been in there? And mm-hmm. can it be fixed? Or if there's something happening with one of my systems that, you know, it's not under warranty anymore, but Joel's amazing, you know, with microphones and stuff. So.
Mm-hmm.
I'll send it to him, and he'll look at it, and he'll say, you know, I can fix this or I can't fix this. And, you know, then I have to go look at, can we buy some more to replace it? And yeah, there's the replacement cost, too,
mm-hmm.
of batteries. Batteries every year. There should be new batteries purchased for every single one of those infrared systems.
Mm-hmm.
Throw out the old ones, start with brand new in September mm-hmm. every year. If there's one problem that would solve everything, that would be it.
And it's not, it's too costly to do the rechargeable angle?
They are rechargeable.
Oh, okay.
They
run out of recharge.
But that's right.
Yeah.
So I need to do a little defensive maneuver here, Michael. That's school equipment and is managed by the school. So if it needs new batteries, then you need to be talking with your school principal. And
so they need to have a budget for that in those schools that have the infrared systems in there.
Mm-hmm.
As that needs to be a line item, replacement of the batteries every year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And see, that's again education.
It's more,
a lot
it's
of times
costs that weren't here 20 years ago.
Well, and
smart boards at my school, projector bulbs or whatever, we have to replace something in those smart board LCD projectors every couple of years, and it's hundreds of dollars per unit.
What do we do in the old overheads with those big, humongous, hotter than anything
lamps? With very loud fans.
Yeah.
Don't
yeah.
sit the deaf child beside that.
I don't know if you want to sit anybody,
But you know what? That's education on the principal. Yeah. And then the principal rotates out to another location, the new one comes in and doesn't know.
Because but they take that education with them, hopefully, to their place.
Yeah, but they came from a school that didn't have the sound field systems, and they know nothing about them.
Yeah.
So, education is what we're in the business of, but it's the entire aspect of it.
Right. Yeah. Nice. So, did you have anything
on
your list?
Well, I didn't know what the format was going to be, so I didn't give much thought to it beforehand. And I thought I'm a special ed teacher at Vicrest Elementary. I've been there 20 years.
Can I get your last name,
Sue? Sue Brown.
Brown. Yeah. Thank you.
And I've seen lots of changes in those 20 years. And as I'm reaching the end of my career,
What?
Both of us. Yeah.
I've seen so many changes, and I'm not having as much job satisfaction as I used to.
Mm-hmm.
The downloading of work has been increasing every year. The complication of my work has been increasing every year. And right now I'm a full-time position at VicWest, as I have been for those 20 years. But when I started, we were a larger school.
Mm-hmm.
We had K-7. There were three of us. And there was a First Nations teacher, and there was a full-time, not a full-time, but we had maybe 3 days a week First Nations counselor, and we had a counselor maybe three times a week. So we had a really rich and vibrant school-based team. We handled, with the administration, we handled all the kind of social problems, the educational problems, the behavioral problems, and it was like a vibrant team. Of course, when the middle schools came up, we went down in enrollment.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe there was only two of me and one First Nations teacher, and maybe the counseling time got cut back a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But starting, I guess, 10 years ago, when the formulas changed, how things were funded, and when schools were funded by headcounts of students, and targeted funding was taken away from special ed kids, it started to change drastically. We went from three special ed teachers to 2.8 specialist teachers to 2.5 to 2 to 1.5, and now it's just the one person doing everything, and it's too much of a load for one person to do. Even an experienced person that doesn't have to learn the paperwork, the jargon, the personnel, it's just a lot to do.
So, a couple of things. First of all, what does the size of the school look like relative to what it was? We've gone from the K-7 to the K-5, and it's to some extent declining enrollment, although
it's
VicWest is kind of holding
its
own now.
We've been under 180. I think there's a magic number. Is it 180 or 200?
Yeah, I think it's a couple of hundred, isn't it, where there's certain breakpoints in the funding for support.
So we have had many years of not having a full-time principal.
Right.
We've had many years of having a full-time secretary, but not the clerical help. And not the clerical help in the library. And when I talk to my partner, who teaches at Sir James Douglas, I can't believe how much stuff they have in the office. Like, there's always two workers in the office. Always. We haven't had that in a long time. And we have just as many kids coming in for Band-Aids, parents coming in.
When you say reduced principal time, you mean principals teaching as well? Is that what's reduced?
I think we have a few. Brent would be a full. No, it's not Brent there. It's
Joe Cardle.
Joe is there now. But for a number of years, Brent was 0.9 principal time, and he took 0.1 out of the special ed budget to pump it up to be full time. So he didn't teach a class for the 0.1.
Mm-hmm.
He beefed it up with special ed time because he dealt with a lot of behavior kids. That was the rationalization. And a lot of the smaller schools did that because all of a sudden it was size counted and we didn't get a full-time principal. Now, that's been rectified in the last couple of years. I'm not quite sure why. I'm not going to ask, but I'm happy that that we have a full-time principal. Brent's last year, he was full-time, and I think John was full-time.
Right. And now, you said that in your view, things are more complicated. Why do you say that?
Today, for instance, I didn't have to deal with SetBC as much as I used to, and I'm really happy about it. I'm having to learn how to use this iPad thing. The technological advances are fabulous for special ed kids, but I have to learn the technology. I have to be meeting with the SetBC. That's one aspect. More medically complicated kids are coming in, so I have to be learning about that, and I have to call a meeting with 10 people around the table, the eating disorder people from QA, the dietitian from QA, the public health nurse who writes the health care plan. It's not like I didn't do that before, I did, but I do it more often. There's more of those kids coming through the school, I think. The fact that, you know, just a small thing, if I'm sending in a referral form to ask for a kid to be psych ed assessment or OT assessment or speech and language, I used to get the signatures, do all the filling in, the information, put it in an envelope and send it out. Now I have to fax it all in. And I've got long paper, I've got double-sided paper. It's just an extra step. Of course, we don't have secretary time to do the clerical.
It's the admin stuff that has increased.
I do clerical work, what I call clerical work, at my big salary. It's way cheaper to get clerical.
Yeah, and that's a really interesting point because, oftentimes when members of the public, but sometimes even trustees, talk about, well, we'll keep it away from the classroom, we'll reduce those kind of administrative costs, but it actually puts more stress in the classroom in terms of the responsibilities that you would have to take on, for example, which takes time away from focused on kids. So it all ties in.
The sound field equipment, the 40 sound field equipment that I manage.
Yeah.
So I have to do all the running around when it breaks, when the microphone doesn't work anymore. Those kids aren't designated.
Previously done
by any time.
382 workers or 947.
Well, I'm just curious about that because there is the monthly mobile, the truck that's going around from AB that's geared for that. So if the work orders are being issued for that equipment when they come to the school.
But they're not your equipment, they're our equipment.
But it's still AB who would be fixing it.
No, it's me.
So you're fixing it?
I'm fixing it.
Okay. If the work orders come in for AV to repair it, then they will do that work.
And how long will it take for AV to get there when a work order gets in?
Well, it all depends. There's two. There's emergency work orders, and then there's routine maintenance.
Okay.
So if something is listed.
So I guess, you know what? Probably the reason why I do it is because if the child can't hear, they might as well not be at school.
I understand why.
Yeah, so then I go fix it.
You go immediately.
Because there's no point in them being here until they can hear.
Another thing I find more complicated is, and I don't know why this happens, but it's been happening for about 10 years, is we don't hire, I have to coordinate the assistants that work with kids in the school. And so we hire a whole bunch in May, and we hold that money back in contingency until the end of September, just in case one of our kids doesn't come back. So we've got a pot of money, but we haven't hired personnel. So we get our starting in September EAGs. So I meet with them all, I train them up on the kid, we write IEPs, we introduce everybody to everyone. And then at the end of September, we get to hire some more. But we wouldn't hire a whole one. We hire like a 0.61 or a 0.41. And then we get some IBI designations coming in. So then we get to hire another 0.2 and maybe we top that person up. So we've got these piecemeal EAGs And I used to be responsible.
Just for the record, by the way, for those who may be listening and wondering what all those acronyms mean.
Where is this going anyway?
It's actually, it's a person who's
a good
he's quite interested in local governance. Done a lot of stuff at a city council level trying to raise the awareness of local governance, and now has taken an interest in trying to elevate the profile of school boards and how we govern and work. And so part of this exercise tonight is to sit down and chat with parents, teachers, school trustees. I tried to summarize it.
Where is this job going? Because
where is it going? Where do you post?
I shoot on YouTube. I do it in an unedited format, generally. This is kind of an unusual meeting for me. I tend to go to where there's a big structured meeting and there's a lot of formality to it. So I'm going to have to talk with you after this, I think, and we'll have to discuss how best to use it, because I think this is an excellent conversation for me. But so far, I think conversations like this are really high.
So just so you know, so there's different elements to the way, for example, we would put together a budget. So we have these, what I would call conversations, as opposed to just kind of talking at one another, which oftentimes it can be good, and there's certain value to it, but it doesn't also allow questions back and forth, so that I, as a decision maker, don't get that opportunity. And so this, we find, is a really good format for that. But there's also other elements in the process where people do get up and will make presentations, and then there will be the deliberation piece, which the board will, which will do in actually setting the budget. So it's different stages. So this is kind of early going, although I should point this out. Lots of consultation has happened already. We talked, it's at a local school level, and getting feedback from parents and teachers and support workers and all the education partners, and we take that all in as well as having sort of public engagement like this. So it's very wide ranging.
Is that publicly available?
Yeah, absolutely. You can have a copy of that unless somebody here wants.
One of the points I'd like to follow up on what Sue said was about these piecemeal EAGs, and you were going to explain that's an educational assistant general, right? That's a challenge for me too, because are you getting the best trained person, the one with the right skills to work with that IBI student, or are you getting the person who needs another point two because they're working in your school, right? And for me, I need EAs working with my students who have an understanding of development of language, an awareness of the challenge of hearing in a classroom, an awareness of the importance of visuals, putting stuff on the blackboard, writing new vocabulary, some background in working with deaf or hard of hearing students. Do they know how to troubleshoot FM equipment or hearing aids?
Maybe another category of EAG to work with.
Okay, so now we get into QP, who doesn't want to do that because that means they're not transferable. They are stuck with that very narrow population. And should that child leave the school, what happens to that EAG?
Could work as a generalist. But this thing with, I'm not quite sure why this happens, but it's been happening for about 10 years. So a given student or classroom could have start the year with assistant one in the classroom, and in November it shift to be, a new person, assistant two, not an additional one, but switch the personnel, and at the end of the year could switch again, because we're always maximizing everybody's hours and rewriting schedules. And we're always getting more people in. We might be able, with the IBI designations happening in February, we might be getting some new ones. I think more money could be coming in, so then we'd have a little bit of money to hire some more, but not enough to do, for full day coverage 5 days a week. So it's just, it's crazy. Like sometimes for this one meeting I'm having next week, I have to speak to four different assistants who work with that same girl. One gets her off the bus, one takes her out for recess, one feeds her lunch, and one works with her in the classroom. Because some of the assistants are paid as EAGs, and some are paid as supervising time. So you can't be having lunch with her if you're being paid supervising time. You've got to be the EAG pay scale has to come in. So that's part of it. And it's just part of it is the way that money is released. It's the way our budget. If we had the budget, if we knew in May that we had enough money and we didn't have to hold back this contingency, we can just hire them, get them up and running, get them trained, and it wouldn't be wasting my time and interrupting me all the time to train yet another one.
Yeah.
It's been, it's very...
And there are other, there's a myriad of other issues that arise. From, you know, nothing is completely settled until those numbers are finalized. There's a bunch of other things.
There's lots of things we'd love to know in May.
Yeah.
And I think it used to be targeted funding. When I started, it was targeting funding. And if you were a student designated learning disability, there was a set amount of money that came to the school for you. Now there is still for the low incidence,
yeah.
But not for those
high incidence is a block.
Not for high incidence. There's just like...
Yeah.
And our school is, I think, you know, is fairly recognized as a Navy school, so we're in a higher formula, so we get money per student with a top-up, because our students are more needy, there's a recognition that way.
Mm-hmm.
We used to be called inner-city, what's it called now?
I think it's called, is it Honorable or is it inner-city? I'm not sure.
But we might have, like I was looking at the board, we have 27 kids at our school with a designation. These aren't kids on the gray area, kids waiting on a list, or are really acting as if they are intensive behavior intervention kids. But because there's no outside agency that will counsel them or psychologically be their psychologist for more than 12 months, they can't be IBI. You see, because what's happening in the outside community with cutbacks to social agencies and they're manning all those non-profit counseling places, that's meaning that our kids can't have their IBI designations because they don't have that outside agency. You understand the difference between the IBI and the MBS?
And no, I don't.
Well, okay, the IBI, well, this is really important. If a kid has got internally emotionally distraught, is interfering with their learning or interfering with the learning of others, and they require a moderate, you know, if they require an intensive amount of support from the teacher, from the EA, from the principal, from the counselor, we go for a designation that they are intensive behavior intervention kids. If they have an outside IBI, if they have an outside agency, then the people at Victor School will say, yep, this will fly by an auditor. We will accept this designation, and then some money comes to the school.
Right.
That money comes to the school will provide an hour and a half of assistant time a day. Now, the kid could be like just having breakdowns a lot or flipping a chair or yelling out, and the most that we could get for extra help is an hour and a half a day, which usually doesn't even come to that. If a kid is like that, but they don't have an outside agency because Mary Manning lost a counselor and they can't support that kid anymore, or the child and youth mental health people could only take a kid on for 12 months, and this is the second year they can't do it. The kid can't be an IBI anymore. They act like one, but they can't get the designation. They're moderately behavior support kids, MBS. No money is generated. No money comes in. And these are the kids in our school that are being supported mainly by being sent to the planning room, which is a restitution model, so they go there and fix your mistake with the worker that's down there, come back to the classroom renewed, but it is ongoing. They're out and they're in, and they're in, because what they really need is kind of somebody, a guide on the side in the classroom to be showing them.
The need is still there, even though the designation
is there. The need is there, and we have more of those kids because the outside agencies aren't as supportive as they used to be.
And that's a criteria. In order to be designated IBI, you must have an outside agency supporting them.
Year by year.
And because of cutbacks to the outside agencies, they are not able to provide that support. Therefore, you can't earn the IBI designation. It's a catch-22.
And that's been going.
It's an unvirtuous cycle. It is.
I know when we do get the kids that do get funding, you work with the students. That falls into this category. She's designated to have autism. She's a low incident student. But the money coming into the school wouldn't provide to have enough money to have an assistant all day, and she really needs one all day to be successful or to even mean to be able to be in a classroom without disturbing others and without disturbing herself and causing embarrassment to herself. But because there's not enough funding coming in for her to have someone all day, she doesn't come the whole day. She stays home for part of the day. So we made a decision for another kid, an IBI kid or an MBS kid. He doesn't have assistant time, and he's not making it through the day. So he's going to stay home in the afternoons. Now, a behavior program might be really appropriate for him, and I'm sure he'll be referred to a behavior program.
Yeah.
And that's what he needs, that therapeutic setting, but I don't think he'll, I don't think there's room for him right now. So he stays home, and that's not a good thing. It will be trouble later for him. So even if the kids do get funding, it's often not enough. And we get the funding for the school meal program. What is that called? What's that funding called? It used to be called the
Community Link.
Community Link. So out of that, we have to pay for the lunch program, which we really value, and it's a fabulous lunch program. The new caterers, it's just dynamite. And then we also purchase a youth and family counselor. But we have her one day less than we did last year, because the money doesn't go as far as anymore. And I think that's also what's happening, is maybe the money is, you know, the money's been cut back for special ed. Maybe not cut back drastically, but when you look at the purchasing power, cut back drastically.
Yeah.
Because wages have gone up.
Well, that's a significant issue. And I know the government often talks about giving more dollars per student and so forth, and that number has been rising. But the reality is the costs
you have to look at the purchasing
have exceeded by
the percentage of increase that
by considerable amounts. So that gap has been widening over the years, and so then you have to make the kind of decisions that you're talking about. So,
you know, when I heard that the student just didn't come to school for a certain period of time, I was really shocked. Mm-hmm. I did not think that we as a school system were allowed to do that.
I didn't think so either.
I didn't think we were allowed to say to a parent, we can't take your child for this period of time at school.
Yeah, yeah. So that's an important thing, obviously, but want to be careful here because we're into the range of privacy issues and I don't want to get into that. But that's the kind of thing I think we need to talk about and address, and a conversation has to happen about that. It's more particular to the issue, but not in the confines of this.
More particular to the issue was that this student that we share has an EA assigned to them, of which, I wasn't consulted when they were hired, yet that student uses hearing aids and FM equipment, and the EA needs to have some knowledge about that.
And even some time for training. This is so shocking. In our old contract, it used to be that if you had a low incident student with autism or moderately mentally handicapped or deaf and hard of hearing or all those other dependent handicap, you were given one morning a month.
3 hours a month.
3 hours
I told
a month.
Okay. Yeah, talk about that.
We don't have it now. So, you know what? An assistant does not talk with the teacher. Now, sometimes they volunteer and they work for free after school to be chatting with the teacher, or work for free before school to chat with the teacher. And they get tired of that. Well, some people don't mind doing it, but most get tired of it soon. And some have other jobs after school.
Yeah.
They have kids after school. You shouldn't be asked to volunteer, but it is such a frustration for teachers because they can never talk to their assistants. They can never do planning. I had an IEP meeting today, and the assistant and the teacher were so excited because they had 10 minutes to talk to each other in between IEP meetings. They were thrilled because they never get to talk. We talk on the fly, We talk in the hallway. We shout at each other in the hallway. We throw materials basically at each other to pass it off because we're always hurrying.
Yeah.
We don't have the dignity to talk to each other.
You know, that is a huge issue. If a classroom teacher is responsible for the education of this child and they need an educational assistant to work with them, the teacher has to have time to direct the assistant on what it is they need to do.
We might hear a week later, or we might see, today I saw in the back of my classroom, an assistant working with the student back there on something I designed for her. All of a sudden the boy is on the floor, and he's crawling away from her, and I'm teaching my group, and there's a woman teaching her group on the computers. I didn't stop my group to go and see. Next thing I know, the principal's coming in to help that boy get down to the planning room. I never had a chance to ask that assistant what happened. No, she leaves at 10 to the hour. I was in meetings till then, then I had another meeting. I might not talk to her for 2 days. And that's the way it is. It's silly. Or I might hear after the fact that, how's it going? Well, this really is not working. And that's okay. It's trial and error. That's teaching. It's art. But we never have a chance to, right away connect that. I had a resource room when we had a bit more money. I had a full-time assistant with me in the morning to deliver a program to 12 kids with learning disabilities. We talked all the time. We had 12 kids. We were a fabulous team. We were talking as we're teaching. She stayed with me the whole morning. You see, a lot of assistants, they're there for 30 minutes. Oh, I got to go relieve so-and-so for the 15-minute recess right now, or their coffee break. I'm going. So assistants don't stay in classrooms. They're on the move. 35 minutes, they're gone. Some stay, but not all. And that's really a problem.
The planning, I think the planning issue is, I think it's kind of right throughout the system. Think about the amount of planning time there is generally. It was one thing I was very interested when I talked to this Patsy Solberg, who was very involved in the Finnish system. I was quite shocked when he talked about, now there's a bunch of different things, culturally different in Finland, they're different from here, keeping in mind. But the amount of time in the classroom is a lot less in Finland. The amount of planning time is substantially more. So this is not individual. This is actually group planning where teachers and support staff get together to figure out exactly, what they're trying to accomplish, how they're going to do it. It's a considerable amount of time. And as to what do kids do who are not in school during this planning time? And so that's where culturally it's a bit different, because in Finland, he said, on average, he said, and not just kids, but adults as well, would belong to 3 clubs. That's not just a membership that they have. It's something that they actually actively do, if it's an athletic club or if it's a photography club or something like that. And oftentimes, those folks will actually know what's going on in the school system. It's that sort of integrated, so they're supporting what's going on in the classroom. So it can be done. It's just a different approach and a different model, and doesn't maybe work in all cultures, but something to think about, I think, when you talk about the kind of planning going on.
Talking about should those resources come, how would we perhaps allocate them out to the schools? And we were, or at least the comments were made that dividing the resources unequally would better address school needs, because not every school has got the same needs. We talked about the importance of early assessments of students in the younger years. We went on to continue the conversation by saying it's the school staffs that know what the needs of the school are, and so how would you create authentic school consultation about how resources would be allocated? There was comments that the funds should be funds made available so that schools have the ability to respond. The concept of perhaps having a district contingency fund that would be available to help address unexpected matters that might arise during the school year, and perhaps more importantly to provide some funding for school level innovation to nurture some new ideas, and with the expectation that there would be the results reported out. We had quite a bit of conversation about providing additional training to educational assistants to elevate their skills, perhaps to a paraprofessional level, and also to increase the hours of their assignment so that it would become a livable wage.
That's great.
Ms. Deborah? And Seamus?
Sure.
And to let you know as well, when we concluded this part, the trustees will be staying behind. If anybody wants to have an individual question with them, we'll stick around for a little while.
Seamus, thank you.
I'm glad Michael is back, because this is not exactly my area of expertise. There's some categories here that I would not be familiar with typically. We had the pleasure of Pam, teacher all the time in the district, and Sue, a special needs teacher at Big West, at our table. And the discussion centered around the caseload that was in the past, 6 to 8 students. And Pam did a brilliant job of telling us how things were and how it's been affected with the changes ever since the targeted funding was changed to funding per student, and how that has affected her job and the students that she deals with. The high number of students that she is now responsible for is very, very challenging, especially with the special designations that go along with those, the high numbers. Also very, very, very limited space available for Pam and the special needs folks in the school. Talked at length about that and the number of special programs competing for that special needs space. The amount of travel that's involved in this job now and the very limited time that's available for that, mostly on the run, having to squeeze lunch breaks and travel time on a regular basis. We had quite a lengthy discussion about the sound equipment that's in the schools, that some of the older equipment that Pam is having to try to keep running, and the facilities got a little challenged on that one. And also the new equipment that's going into the school that is, according to Pam, it should be in all classrooms in the schools, and we had some information that it's been explored extensively in the K-5 in other districts. Along with the installation of this equipment, we were told very clearly there needs to be an allocation for training, not only for the teachers, but for the EAs who are using this equipment as well. Michael, am I?
Yes, great, you're doing a great job.
One of the things that Sue referred to here was the fact that the teachers are becoming very frustrated because they never get to spend quality time, sit-down time to talk with the EAs, that the EAs don't spend a lot of time in the classroom with the teachers, that they're traveling around relieving people within the school. There was some discussion as well about the whether or not the right mix is there as far as qualifications for people dealing with deaf and hard of hearing children, that sometimes the hours are simply tacked on to the existing staff, and it may not necessarily be the qualified staff that they would, that should be getting that time. And I'll hand in my notes, and hopefully you can make sense of them.
Our group learned some interesting facts. 21% of our previous responses say more funds should be provided to special education. 5% of the responses say some funds should be allocated to areas such as the speech and language pathologists. Some suggestions for finding additional funds for the SLPs would be to tap into other budget areas, such as the money in special ed that we utilize currently for EAs, because the SLP staff also provide support for those special needs children. They also believe that First Nations funding could be looked at, as they also, once again, provide services to this group of students as well. And the third area to look at is where the district spends non-direct money where other districts do not. So some districts will spend money in certain areas where we don't, where we will not spend money where we do, is the other way of phasing. Help with the requirements budget that will be a subsidiary budget that we're going to work on. They believe that it'll take 2.25 FTE speech and language pathologists to provide a minimum requirement for the district, and 9.8 to give the same levels we had several years ago. They believe it's difficult for us to find qualified psychologists to fill all the needs of the district. Therefore, we have a retention and recruitment problem. In some areas to look at to perhaps help that would be to pay psychologists some more money, offer more flexible unpaid time off so that they could work together. They also felt that additional professional development money to provide appropriate courses to allow them to maintain their credentials could also be a method of helping people to stay with the district. They commented on space needs. There should be space provided at each school site to provide space for the itinerants to use when they're there. And one of the last comments is that this staff should have, particularly the SLP, should have iPad devices that will assist them in working with children with their special needs.
Thank you, George. Okay, I have two trustees at the next table, so who's going to play over my microphone? Janine.
Yes.
Thank you. In an area that should be given priority to support when there is a point that was addressing the weight of for educational and design assessment to be targeted. And we spend a lot of time at our table talking about government funding provided to education and concerns about funding levels and concerns about carbon tax taking education dollars as well. And so there's a real focus on increasing per student funding for them. Thanks, Jean. At our table, we have a parent, Leanne, and Leanne has students in the Reynolds Family of Schools, and we've got Denise, who's a teacher at Old Bay, and Nancy, a kindergarten teacher from Rogers. I won't repeat what other tables have said, but we spent the majority of our time talking about support, learning support in particular. We also talked about psychology and speech and language. Talked about early intervention. So we had a lengthy conversation about learning support, reading recovery, and how important early intervention is for the students. Talked about what it's like at the kindergarten level where the students come in not designated, and later on they get designated, but there's little support when they first come in. We talked about equity across the system and having to support students with low incidence that aren't supported by the government.
whether or not I have anything useful, but this is just a brief summary. We started off by talking about the benefits of music programs in our schools and how important they were. We went on to talk about a variety of issues, including the importance of special ed teachers and psychologists and the work that they do in our district, and maintaining professional teaching counselors in our schools. We talked about direct funding to special needs students who may not have IEPs, but nonetheless it's obvious to many of us that there are those needs there. We talked about classroom composition issues, more planning time for teachers and for teachers and EAs together, because often in their it doesn't really make sense for our EAs to spend so much time with kids and know them so well, not to be in some of those planning meetings. When we talk about class size, particularly elementary and middle, and tech ed classes in particular. Talking about the idea of an early childhood educator working in a K or K-1 class, which was an interesting idea. More importantly for technology, as we are gradually doing more and more technology in our schools and bringing people to school. So, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom, and thanks to all of you that have come out tonight and participated. It's really important that we do this, and we actually need to put together real statistics to show the gap between what we're being funded for and what we actually need to have a robust educational system. So that's what our goal is to be working on, and the board will be deliberating and making decisions in April. I'd just like to remind all of you that our next board meeting is on March the 28th, and at that time we will have a preliminary budget to present, and we'll be taking into consideration the information that's been provided to us through the fall and then through these meetings, and it's extremely important. The notes that have been taken tonight will be typed and sent to all the trustees and posted on the web. That should be done within a week or so. And I'd just like to say that, again, the trustees are willing to stay behind and talk to anybody, but our focus, this board's focus, is our belief that a focus on education is a focus on the future, and we look forward to your input on this very important matter. So thanks again for taking the time to come out. And if you can, please encourage friends, family, neighbors, grandparents, whomever, to come out and give their input as well. Thank you.